Our first scripture continues the story of Moses from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 34, verses 1 through 7. Then Moses hiked up the Moabite plains to Mount Nebo, the peak of Pisgah slope, which faces Jericho. The Lord showed him the whole land, the Gilead region as far as Dan's territory, all the parts belonging to Naphtali, along with the land of Ephraim and Manasseh, as well as the entirety of Judah as far as the Mediterranean Sea. Also the arid southern plains and the plain including the Jericho Valley, Palm City, as far as Zoar. Then the Lord said to Moses, "This is the land that I swore to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob when I promised I will give it to your descendants. I have shown it to you with your own eyes. However, you will not cross over into it." Then Moses, the Lord's servant, died right there in the land of Moab, according to the Lord's command. The Lord buried him in a valley in the Moabite country across from Beth Peor. Even now, no one knows where Moses' grave is. Moses was 120 years old when he died. His eyesight wasn't impaired, and his vigor hadn't diminished a bit. And from Paul's letter to the Hebrews, chapter 12. So then, let's run the race that is laid out in front of us, since we have such a great cloud of witnesses surrounding us. Let's throw off any extra baggage, get rid of the sin that trips us up, and fix our eyes on Jesus, faith's pioneer and perfecter. He endured the cross, ignoring the shame, for the sake of the joy that was laid out in front of him, and sat down at the right hand of God's throne. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, and for the word of God within us, we say,
thanks be to God.
Ready, aim, fire, right? When you're about to start dodgeball? Is that how your gym teacher starts it?
No.
That's probably for the best. It's a little aggressive way to start dodgeball. But people say it as like a on your mark, get set, go kind of thing. Ready, aim, fire. But we're reading this book called Dare to Dream, right? And the author in the book says we should say ready, fire, aim. How do you think we would do that? You know, it sounds bad because you get ready and normally you aim at what you want to hit, right? And then you fire. But the author says we should ready, fire, and then aim. How are you going to do that? Well, he says that we should let God aim. So we get ready, we fire whatever we've got, and we let God aim it where it needs to go. So that means a lot of you, I remember a lot of you said you wanted to be a chef when you grow up. Or what else was there that you wanted to be when you grow up? Football, basketball, vets. So sometimes we know what we want to do, but we don't know who to help with it. So you just start doing it, and God will show you. God will bring you the people that need that help. And sometimes we don't know what to do, but we know the people we want to help, right? Maybe we want to work with kids or animals or other people. So we don't know how to help them, but we can go wherever they are, and God will show us what they need, how we can help. So that's what it means to ready, fire, aim. And it's not an easy thing to do because it takes some faith, right? You have to believe that God will aim for you. So we're going to watch a video, a pep talk from Kid President to help us with this tough work. Okay? You ready?
I think we all need pep talk. The world needs you to stop being boring. Yeah, you. Boring is easy. Everybody can be boring, but you're gooder than that. Life is not a game, people. Life isn't a cereal eater. Well, it is a cereal. And if life is a game, aren't we all on the same team? I mean, really, right? I'm on your team. Be on my team. This is life, people. You got air coming through your nose. You got heartbeat. That means it's time to do something. A poem. Two roads diverged in the woods, and I took the road less traveled.
It hurt, man!
Really bad.
Rocks, thorns, and glass.
My pants broke. Wah! Not cool, Robert Frost. But what if there really were two paths? I want to be in the one that leads to awesome. It's like that dude Journey said, don't stop believing, unless you dream stupid. Then you should get a better dream. I think that's how it goes. Get a better dream and keep going. Keep going, keep going, and keep going. Will Michael Jordan have quit? Well, he did quit. No, he retired. Yeah, yes, he retired. But before that, in high school, what if he quit when he didn't make the team? He would have never made Space Jam. And I love Space Jam. What will be your Space Jam? What will you create will make the world awesome? Nothing if you keep sitting there. That's why I'm talking to you today. This is your time. This is my time. It's our time. We can make every day better for each other. If we're all on the same team, let's start acting like it. We got work to do. We can cry about it, or we can dance about it. We were made to be awesome. Let's get out there. I don't know everything. I'm just a kid. But I do know this. It's everybody's duty to give the world a reason to dance. So get to it. You've just been pep talked. Create something that will make the world awesome. Play ball.
All right. Thanks, Kid President. That's our pep talk. We gotta keep going and keep going and keep going, even when it's hard, and do the thing that we are made to do that'll make the world awesome. So that is what Moses did. That's the story we read from the Bible. He kept going for 40 years. He walked through the desert and he finally made it to the promised land. And God will help us achieve our goals too. So let's pray, because we're going to need the help. God, we thank you for making us for a reason and for giving us a purpose. We pray that you would help us keep going, even when it's hard, to accomplish your dream for the world. We ask your blessing on these children, that you would keep them safe and bring them back next week to learn more about you. And all of God's children said, Amen. We have a great opportunity coming up in the season of Lent. And I first want to remind you about these orange sheets. There's still a good stack by the door. If you didn't get one or haven't filled one out yet, we'd like this orange sheet back so we can know how to best serve our church during this season and in the months and years ahead. What things can we provide that will help you grow deeper in your spiritual faith? And the other sheet in there is to help you identify where you might be at in your spiritual life so that you know where you're at and how to take the next step in getting closer to God. And so this is one you will keep. Take home and fill it out for your own information. But this one, if you could fill out and put it in the box that's labeled surveys in the library, we would much appreciate that. Because this season of Lent, we're going to be focusing on truly being disciples, not just churchgoers, but really being disciples of Christ. And so in the last 4 weeks of Lent, we're going to be offering a discipleship class. And this is particularly for folks who might be interested in joining the church as a member, but it's also for people who want to go deeper, take the next step, and learn what it means to be a disciple within our United Methodist context. So I wanted to invite Mike, one of our lay leaders, Mike Burley, to come forward and share what it has meant for him. He joined the church a few years ago after attending for a long time, and I wanted him to give you his take on why that was significant.
For me, when I first came to the church, I would often look at the announcements and not know what a lot of them meant. I swear to you, when I first heard about Hannah Plow, I thought it meant that the church had some gardening ministry or something. I didn't know. This class provided me with that information to learn what our church itself offers. It provided me with background knowledge on the Methodist church as a whole, which I wasn't familiar with. Since that class, I think it's enabled me to invest more in the church, to be more committed to the church. I'm regularly here at this point. I've willingly and enthusiastically joined several ministries that we do. So throughout the couple of years that I've been here, I've grown and become, and these ministries have helped me personally become closer to God. To give back to the church, which has really given me so much for the past several years. So I encourage you all to join. It's informative. It's kind of fun. And you'll learn quite a bit.
Thank you. So if you're interested in joining us for that four-week session, please let me know. And the easiest thing to do would be to fill out and make sure we have your name and contact information to fill out one of those cards in the pews. But if you think we already have that, you can let me know that you want to join us, and we will find the day and time that will work best for those interested. So that's why I don't have that specific yet, but that's to be determined by those who want to take that class with us. So I invite everyone, even if you've been a member your whole life, but would like a refresher or would like to know a little bit more or particularly to go deeper in the season of Lent, please, I invite you to join us. And now I would ask you to please pray for me as I pray for you. Let us pray together. living God, make your truth known to us today and forever. O Lord, you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, church, we have been dreaming and praying for 6 weeks now, and it's time. It's time to put pen to paper. Are you ready to claim the purpose for your life? So, if you're still not sure where to even start in terms of writing a life mission statement, which is what we've been working on these past 6 weeks, I thought I would share some examples with you, because that always helps me. So I posted the question on a Christian Facebook group I'm a part of, just asking, what do you consider as a life mission statement for yourself? And here's some of the responses I got. My mission is to live my life making art, using different mediums, and spreading God's word through love by helping my fellow marginalized people to rise up and teaching people to learn self-confidence. My mission is to share and spread peaceful parenting like wildfire. My mission is to help people find the lives they want to live. And I'll share some of the examples in our Dare to Dream book that they share. My life mission is to connect with the younger generation so they aren't afraid of religion or start to turn away from it, to help them find their way back. My life mission is to seek and develop opportunities to teach, mentor, and guide retirees and retirement age members in our church. My life mission is to organize groups to serve people in need by providing one-day home improvement services. My life mission is to help children through the pain of neglect or feeling unloved and living through the struggle of abuse. My mission is to end slavery, especially in sex trafficking. I want to use the strengths of strategic planning to grow funding and awareness in Ohio's link in the worldwide trafficking network. I also want to use my strengths to enhance and develop the local programs that build self-worth for abused women. These are some pretty cool life mission statements. And they were definitely helpful to hear and read as I was working on mine. So, here it is. I was made to help people know how much they are loved by their Creator and to act accordingly. My mission is to help people see how good the world can be when we live how God originally intended, and to help people live that way without fear or shame, caring for each other and the earth, while trusting God to guide us in each of our part of God's plan to save the world. Now, clearly, all of these mission statements are individualized for the people who wrote them, so you can't just copy one. Sorry. But I hope that hearing them helps get you thinking. Because there's lots of right answers, as you just heard. There's lots of right ways to answer this question. Some were very specific, some more general, some were long and had plans and mission steps in them. Some were short and simple. Your mission statement can be whatever you are led to, in your own words. It can be anything except a blank page. I hope all of us are inspired at this point to write something out. Because I'll tell you, I thought about it a lot, and I, you know, would start to think of something and say, oh no, that's no good, or get stuck, and I just kept thinking, I'll come back to it. But if I didn't think that you all wanted to hear mine today, I might have never finished it. I might have never written it down. So I want to do the same favor for you. I want to expect to hear your mission statement. I'm going to be asking people to tell me the purpose you were made. You can send it to me in an email. You can share it to me on your way out the door if you know it. Put it in my mailbox. Let me know. I want to know why each of you was made. I think that's an important thing for a church family to know about each other. I got started just by saying to myself, I was made to, and then I wrote something down and read it over and didn't love it, came back to it, wrestled with the words a little bit, and as I started getting frustrated, I just closed my eyes and took a deep breath. That I was made to, and it just sort of flowed out. And then a little while later, as I was thinking about that, trying to confirm that, yeah, that feels right, another part of that mission statement came to me, and I had to write it down quickly before I forgot it. We've done the work together these past 6 weeks. We've put in a lot of thought around this topic. So hopefully we might all be at that point where we can take a deep breath and close our eyes and confidently say, I was made to, and finish that phrase. Now, if that's not happening, it's okay. But don't give up on it. Keep working on it. Keep going back to it. Don't put it off. Because I'm going to be asking. I want to know what you were made to do. And you know, it might not be anything revolutionary or anything really new. It might be what you've been doing all along, but there is value in writing it down, putting words on a paper and putting that somewhere that you'll see it. The author of our book says he writes his mission at the top of the first page of every journal he uses. So, I gave you some cards. If you didn't get one, there's extras by the door. This is for you to keep. To write down why you were made. And to put this somewhere that you will see often. Put it on your computer, in your car, on the fridge. Somewhere you frequent to remind you why you're alive. Why you're breathing, why your heart is beating. That's important. Because we're going to need a daily reminder, because it's going to get hard, right? As soon as we write it down, well, that was the easy part. Then we've got to start doing it. Now, some of you might be able to write something down really easily and then sort of want to put it away, because you don't really know where to start. Well, thankfully, Scripture has some good advice for us, as always. We've been reading about Moses these past few weeks. So let's look, what did he do? When he got his life mission statement from God in the burning bush to go to Pharaoh and tell him to let the Hebrew slaves free, how did he start? He turned towards Egypt, and he took a step, and another step. He took step after step after step a million times until he found himself at Pharaoh's door. Putting one foot in front of the other, he pointed himself in the direction God wanted him to go and simply did the next thing that he had to do. In recovery circles, they say, just do the next right thing. Just take the next step on the path that God has laid out before you. And simply by doing that, you will be living God's dream for your life. But you've got to take a step. Now, I admit, my mission is a little scary to me. It seems kind of big. I'm supposed to help all people, everybody, know that God loves them, and then get them to treat each other like fellow children of God. I don't want to be one of those crazy people on the street corner asking everybody if they've been saved. When we write our mission down, it's going to feel a little daunting to have it staring back at you. But as we heard last week, when Moses was feeling daunted, God asked, well, what's in your hand? That's where you start. What have you got? Where are you? Start where you're at. Use what you have right now. So I'm going to take that opportunity. I've got you all. Got your ear. Allow me to remind you right now that you are a beloved child of God. You are worthy. The God who created the universe made you and loves you. So act like it. Now, like Moses, I have no idea where this path will lead. We might not have any clue what God's dream is going to look like for our lives. Because once he went to Pharaoh and got the Hebrew people free, God wanted him to keep going, to lead them through the wilderness to the promised land. But as we know, that was no simple hike through the desert. There were setbacks, like 40 years of setbacks. And so we've got to know, right? The same is going to be true for our mission. There's going to be setbacks. There's going to be obstacles. The path that God calls us to walk is not the easy road. It is definitely the path less traveled. It's going to be hard. But God promises to be with us, provide what we need when we need it. All we have to do is keep going, keep taking the next step. Pastor Mike Slaughter, the author of the book we've been reading, Dare to Dream, said in the book that one of his favorite quotes comes from a writer, Robert Louis Stevenson, who said, "Saints are sinners who keep going." Saints are sinners who keep going. Most great success stories come after thousands of failures. You've heard this, right? You know, like Thomas Edison had something like 3,000 different theories for the light bulb before he found the one that worked. And Einstein said he wasn't smart. He just stayed at problems longer. Moses went to Pharaoh 9 times before he finally agreed to let the Hebrews go. Whatever God's dream is for your life, you've got to know to just keep at it. Keep going back to it. You may be one failure away from success. We've got to be persistent. But we can also see from the story of Moses that we are allowed to stop and catch our breath. This dream that God has for your life isn't meant to run you to your grave. There were many times when Moses went away, took some time off from the Israelites. He would usually go up a mountain to be alone with God, to catch his breath, survey the land. There are going to be major hills for us to climb on our journey. And so once you get to the top of one, I want to encourage us to stop and catch our breath. And from that new elevation, we'll be able to see a better lay of the land. We might get a little bit of a glimpse of where God is leading us to go. At the end of his life, God led Moses up one last mountain, we read, to a point where he could see the whole promised land, the land flowing with milk and honey. And God said, you're not going to make it there yourself, but you completed your mission. Moses' people would finally get to settle in this prosperous land after years of being enslaved and then wandering the desert. He had accomplished his mission, and he never gave up. Though, if you read his story from start to finish, you will see time after time after time, he wanted to abandon the whole thing. He kept going. He was given his purpose, and though he had no idea where it would lead, he took the first step. And he kept taking next step after next step, even when it seemed impossible, when they had no food in the desert, no water. He kept going, and God provided. He persisted through the distractions and the detractors, and God was faithful to him. God got Moses to the promised land, and we know the promise of our faith is that God will get us there too. There is a reason you were made. There is a reason you were made. You have a purpose in this world. So take the next step on that path that God has given you. And God promises to see us through to the end. And the beautiful thing is that when other people see our persistence, they'll be inspired to keep going. And through our collective work, persisting on the mission God has given each one of us, God will transform our world through each one of us. Just take the first small step, and God will help you take the next million more.